All right, today we're going to finally get on the tuning on the 67 Mustang 302 that we're going to be throwing back in that engine bay here pretty shortly, hopefully. And what I wanted to do is kind of go over what my tuning package is for these cars. I'm going to grab one thing from back over here. Now, what I've got on the table here is pretty much everything I'll be using to tune the car. One thing that's not on the table is my vacuum gauge, which is already on the engine stand over there, so I'm not going to pull that in to show you here. But we are tuning now. We are not trying to run in the cam, so we're a little more picky about how things are going to go. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pull all the plugs out of it, and I'm going to check with my compression gauge that we've got good compression all the way around the engine. I'm not worried about the volume of compression, as long as they're consistent across the board. We're probably going to be running in the 150 PSI on the cylinders, so we're going to check that here in a second. That is the very first thing we're going to do, because without the correct compression in the cylinders, you're already in trouble. So you might as well not go any further and start diagnosing the problem that you have right there. Another thing we've got here on the table is something I bought a long time ago. This is a Holley tuning kit. We run Holleys around here, so we have a Holley tuning kit that has gaskets and jets and power valves, all the needful things that you'll have for a carburetor. We're hoping to just kind of stay where we're at because this carburetor is in pretty decent shape. It ran really well before we had to pull the engine out and do the stuff we needed to do to it. So we're hoping that we can stay right where we're at with the jets and the power valve and not have to break into this kit, but you should always have one around. Yes, they are pretty expensive. You can get these from like Summit, but if you buy one, it'll probably last you a lifetime with minor refills here and there for power valves and jets and things like that. Another thing that's going to be really hard to come by, especially now, is a distributor wrench like the one I've got sitting right here. This distributor wrench is specific for Ford. It's got the correct half inch down here at the end. The little ones that you can get that are, you know, you put them together and all, honestly, I've never had any success with them. This type right here, which has been out of stock for forever, is my favorite. Now, this is a Craftsman part. Honestly, you're probably only going to find this thing on eBay, or if you go to a yard sale and some old man has been working on Fords his whole life. When I die, one of these will be available because I have two. Don't wait that long. Go ahead and try to find one now. You can find them out there in the market. Behind that, I've got a brace of three screwdrivers. These are my two Holley screwdrivers, what I call my Holley screwdrivers. You'll notice that the tip on this one has been cut off, and this is so that I can take that big screw loose on the top to adjust the floats on the carburetor. This one is a little bit shorter. It's basically the same purpose, but this is the one I use for my jets because I want a big broad screwdriver head on those jets so you don't peel the ends of them. This long narrow screwdriver is the one I use for doing the idle mixture screws on the sides of the carburetor, and also for going in and setting the idle up on a carb. Hopefully we'll get to that point today. If you don't have an ignition switch, this is something you're going to have in your toolkit. The remote starter is a great idea because it'll let you do the things you need to do with going in and turning the engine over for your compression tests and things like that. I always have one of these in my kit. The little trouble lights like this with the incandescent bulb in them are always nice to be able to find if you've got voltage to the areas you need to have it. And finally, on the end here, I've got a cobalt thermal gauge. This is basically an infrared so that we can stick it right to where the exhaust manifold ports are at when we're running the engine in to see what our exhaust temperatures are at the ports, and also what we're running at the thermostat and places like that. We want to know that our temperatures are running pretty good. We were running a little hot the last time when we were trying to run the engine in for the cam, and I'm hoping that we don't run into that today when we're starting to do our tuning. This is a basic tuning that we're going to be doing. You can also run a timing light, but I find a vacuum gauge that's like the one we have on the engine stand over here works just about as well to give you what you need to know, because if you get the vacuum up to where it is roughly, you know, around 20 inches of vacuum, which is what these 302s and 289s typically run for engine vacuum, you're good to go. And you may have to even back it off from there a little bit in order to get it to where it'll start correctly and not labor understarting and also ping when you're going down the road. So it's just a good way to tune it in. I like vacuum tuning. A lot of guys like timing lights. It's just a kind of either or depending on what you want. We have a timing light. is sitting over here on the engine, so we'll be using that if we need to. Now, without further ado, Cam and I are going to be pulling plugs out of this thing so that we can do a compression test on it to make sure we are where we need to be. Plugs are tight. Yes, I would normally be using a plug wrench. Doesn't look like number 7 was firing. There's nothing on it. It's a little weird. Number 8. Now I'll go around to the other side and take those out as well, put them in a rack, and we'll take a look at them. Cam and I will discuss what's going on. And by the way, Cam is back today. He's just a little foot sore.
All right, so we have the plugs out of this. Some of them not looking that great. 5, 6, and 1 are all fuel rich. The rest of them are pretty lean, or not lean, but just less fuel than the rest. 7 is doesn't look like it's been firing very much. Personally, I probably wouldn't give much credit to these at the moment, because the valves were coming loose when we were running it before. So that'll change the vacuum signal to each cylinder, which will cause more fuel to be drawn to others that have stronger vacuum signals. Nothing stands out as like really, really bad though. Just fuel rich. So we're gonna keep going with the compression test and see what we got.
Fire in the hole.
Right, that's 140.
Not quite the 150 we were hoping for.
Yeah, as long as they're nominal.
Yeah. What's the percentage on that supposed to be? Like within 10% of each other?
Yeah, 10% is a good starting point.
Fire in the hole!
Right. 145. Those are definitely getting oil.
They're getting what?
Those are definitely getting oil.
Yeah, that last one, that last pair down there, you get plenty of oil.
Right, 140.
Well, so far, Cam, it looks like we've done good.
Yeah, 5 PSI difference is not bad.
No, not on a street engine especially.
And dry.
Yeah, bone dry. That's low.
Nah, I mean 138.
Oh, 138?
Yeah.
Fire in the hole.
That's 140.
Fire in the hole. That could be valves not closing all the way.
Possible. The real test of that will be once it's actually running, though.
Yeah.
The lifters have full pressure. Go for it.
Fire in the hole.
Mm, 135.
So all within tolerance.
Yeah.
You got that 10% you're looking for on a street engine.
Yeah. And quite frankly, even if it was, I would be fine with one at like 120, honestly.
Yeah. Again, street engine. And it's a, you know, it's a backyard rebuild. It's not like we sent it to a shop and had this stuff done. Yeah. So. All right. So I guess now we need to charge the battery.
Yeah, that would help.
So you want to put it on a 10 amp? Charge?
Yeah.
All right, so now we're going to charge the battery up for a little while, and we're going to sit down and kind of look at everything. Make sure everything's still copacetic on the engine. Probably take the fuel out of the fuel bowl on the Holley so we're not running old fuel. Grab our gas tank and get everything ready to do our run tests.
Of course, knew it was gonna happen.
I gave you a pan,
mm-hmm.
a big pan,
mm-hmm.
and you
mm-hmm.
still got it on the floor.
You're welcome.
I got something else to clean up.
So I have the filter material cut out. You saw I put it in a vise, squeezed it in a Ziploc bag. That's to push all the oil out of it and just make it easier to see. We do have some metal, a couple flakes. All this stuff is like really powdery. And I would mostly attest that to like flashing on the camshaft, lifters breaking in. There's nothing in here that's like solid actual pieces of metal. You run your fingers over all of this and it turns to powder when you wipe it down. See all that's just powderizing. None of this I would be really concerned about. If you had a camshaft failure, this would be slap full of metal, and it would also be, most times it's a lot stringier pieces where it's actually eating off the camshaft. None of this is really worrisome for me, especially on a fresh rebuild. I mean, most of the time you cut one of these open on a running engine, like when you do an oil change, it's going to look like this. So I think we are good to go. But you can also see this media is just paper thin. So good filters. It's worth it. So as far as what filters to buy, I would always recommend OEMs or a high-grade aftermarket like AMSOIL filters. Donaldson's a good one as well. Just OEMs though, if you can. Always OEMs. Because that's no good.
All right, first test. We started it just a second ago. We know it'll start. We don't know if we can keep it running at this point. We think we have way too much timing in it. Exhibiting because of the blowback we had through the carburetor right there at the very end. So I've backed the timing off a little bit. Now we're going to try to start and see what we get.
All right, ready?
Fire in the hole.
Contact.
Still too much. Try that.
Contact.
Better.
A little more out of it.
Yep. Rather. Why is it doing that? Oh, we don't have the...
Oh, yeah, that'll help.
We forgot to hook the fuel back up. so that's probably why it died. You're gonna hear wind noise in my mic, I'm sorry. I'm gonna go ahead before he starts it back up and do a idle screw or mixture screw adjustment, just to make sure. I'm gonna go 1 1/2 on this just for initial set. Everything's in the way. We could actually run the choke now if we wanted to. We're 1 1/2 out on mixture screws.
Ready again?
Let's try it again.
Contact.
It's gonna look a little rough when it's idling because it is hard mounted to the stand. Probably back the timing off still just a little bit. Yeah. 23 inches of vacuum I'm okay with.
It dropped down to 21 at a low idle.
That's good. That means we're right about where we need to be on the timing. Now we would know from a hot start, if it labors on a hot start, if we need to back timing out a little bit more. But it's really shooting. We got plenty of oil pressure at idle.
Yeah.
Because we're shooting at the valve covers. It's still oil in the lifters or oil in the rockers on these that are like that, but I can see, because I can see the oil pooled up.
Yeah.
Down inside the rocker.
But it's streaming off of them.
Huh?
It's steady.
It's pissing, man.
You want to retry it, see if the timing's hot?
Yep.
Starter's hot.
No! I'm not moving. I'm leaving that right where it is. This bank is still running rich.
Yeah.
That's a carburetor issue.
Yeah.
We have it running.
All right, good.
I wonder if that fuel pump might be overpowering the needle and seat a little bit.
Might be.
It starts right up. I think we're right where we need to be.
Actually, no, it wasn't, because...
It wasn't up. Well, there you go. That's why it died. Okay, so we lost our fuel pump again because we're running off of a wire. I'm telling you what, dude, I'm ready to pop it off in the engine bay as it sits.
Yeah.
This is in good enough set right now that we got plenty of oil pressure on the on the inside of the engine. All this carburetor tuning I would rather do with a full exhaust system on it the way it's going to run. But what you'll want to do is you'll want to adjust those mixture screws on the side of a Holley are really key to better performance out of your Holley at idle and all that. If you get them adjusted just right, it'll idle flat and true, especially with a stock style cam in it. Right now what we're running into is we don't have any exhaust on it, so it's running straight out of the manifold. I am seeing a little bit richer run on the driver's side than I am on the passenger side.
Did you close down the secondary idle jets? Because this has four corner idle.
Oh boy, no I did not.
That's probably it.
I don't even know where they're at. They're almost shut. I don't remember on that, honestly. I don't remember if you're supposed to adjust the secondary idle or not, or secondary screws for idle. I'll have to look that up. I'll do that later. It's a beast of a carburetor for that engine.
Yeah, it's way too much carburetor. Well, CFM's not bad, but it's...
What's the temperatures like on the exhaust manifold?
530, 600, 600.
So we're...
A little cold on the front.
That may be where that ridge point's coming from then. We may
that,
have to
that
jet
That was
up.
The richest plug as well, was that front plug.
Yes, it was. We may have to jet up. If it's running lean, that lean on the rest is, although that one being a little rich, that could be fuel puddling as well.
Yeah.
It runs well enough that I'm comfortable with putting it in the engine bay. I was really worried about this thing because when we did the test run in the first break-in, the way it was running was terrible. And this is actually cleaned up nice enough. If we had it in standard engine mounts, we'd have a better idea of whether it's a problem with vibration or not. Well, I guess that's a cut it, print it. All right, one more time. I want to play with it a little bit. I want to see how it does on a hot start.
All right, ready?
Yep.
Contact. I think it's dialed.
I think it is dialed. I think we're good to go, man.
Good oil pressure, good vacuum, steady vacuum. That's a major thing. If a cam problem.
Yeah, I was really concerned about that with what we were experiencing when we did the engine run-in before. It was all over the map.
Yeah.
And now it's not. Now we got a good steady 21 inches of vacuum, which is perfect. You got a booster on there. Yeah. That'll be perfect for the power brake booster. I'm ready to throw this thing in the engine bay, but I want to put the engine dress on the front. Actually, what we ought to do is show the guys out there what we're going to do for this engine to dress it out. Now, we've got a pretty engine bay. We're going to make a pretty engine for them to take a look at. So that's going to be next coming up on the engine. But man.
Runs good.
Runs really good. I'm really excited for him. He's going to be happy with this. I mean, it's a good running little engine. Got plenty of power, I think, for what he wants to do most likely. With the 4R70W, he'll be...
Big. Really nice cruiser.
Yep, he'll be able to motor pretty well. Well, folks, that's our show for this week. We are both very ecstatic. You can look at Cam and tell how happy he is.
This is my happy face.
Well, that's his happy face. We're really ecstatic about this, but do me a favor. Be kind to each other, love on each other, treat each other nice. You guys have a great week, and we'll see you next time on Auto Resto Mod.
One more time.
Perfect!
Minty.
I still got it, man. I thought when we did it before we were done, I'm like, well, we're going to probably have to pull the engine down and do all this other stuff. But man, it just cracks right off. Yes! A happy Jeffy is a happy Jeffy.
Nice.
Yes. All right, now we got to let it cool off to take it back in the garage.